Academic Prep sponsored my trip to the most recent international TESOL convention. I spent some time sitting at their corporate booth in the convention exhibit hall. It was interesting. A lot of people are curious about academic prep, and some people are against it, very much against it. But the people who were very much against it didn't really seem to understand the way things work. They saw it as... I think a lot of academics think of business as evil. If you're in academia, you probably know what I mean. Oh, corporate influence, bad. And they don't realize that, actually, higher education is a business. It's a business. Otherwise, we wouldn't have any jobs, right? You got to pay your teachers somehow. So a few people at the convention were very critical of what we were doing and weren't really interested in learning about it. They didn't understand and didn't want to understand. But the people who were interested because they saw it as a way to maybe grow their own programs. You know, some programs are pretty small. Maybe they have some sort of disadvantage geographically or historically. Especially young teachers saw it as a job opportunity. But I think there's interest. I think this model is going to spread. It's not going to spread everywhere, but I think there's a place for it. And I don't really think it's anything to be afraid of. All it's going to do is increase the number of students coming to America to study. It's not a zero-sum game, so I don't see the problem. I'll tell you, if universities are looking for teachers with experience, and if they hire somebody that's been working for us for a while, they'll have someone with some experience. I think if anybody should be worried about this sort of paradigm, it's, well, not necessarily worried, but concerned. Look, if universities can do this for ESL, then why can't they do it for math? You know, when I was teaching abroad, there was this issue with corporations bringing their own faculty in to teach ESL classes. It was cheaper for the university to completely outsource instruction than to hire their own faculty, you know, like bringing in a Berlitz or something. And I was in a faculty meeting and they were saying, oh, we should just bring in this corporation to teach our English courses. And I said, you know, that's a great idea. And we should also bring in teachers for math, because math is really easy to teach. We don't need to hire a tenured professor to teach math. And that just shut the whole conversation down. And the truth is this, why do we need a full professor to teach Math 101? I don't know. It's pretty simple stuff. It's either right or it's not. It's a lot easier than teaching language, where, you know, there can be 50 answers to one question. So I think, and this is the year 2011, if we're using a university system modeled on late Middle Ages Europe, I mean, why are we doing that? Is it in the best interest of the society which pays for these learning institutions? Is it in the best interest of the student? I don't know. But I can see there's a lot of value to the system as we know it, but is it a good investment of resources? I think for a lot of people, if you ask, what are your best experiences from university? It's going to have nothing to do with Math 101. It has to do with that girl you met on the third floor of the dormitory when you were drunk out of your mind, you know? Then you have a story to tell. Yeah. I don't know. The future will be interesting. And hopefully I'll live long enough to be involved in the process. It's interesting.